church.
Thank you.
It's all natural. God, you're so great. You know the plans you have for us. You know where you're taking us and where we're going, God. You go ahead of us, Lord. Thank you, Father, because everything is under your control, God.
Oh, Hallelujah. Amen. Holy Spirit, just come before you right now, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you're the calmer of the storm. We thank you that you're the one that tells us, see to be still, Lord. We can trust in you here this evening. We can rest in you here this evening. We can put everything aside and just give it to you, Lord. And know, Lord, that you have all the answers, Lord. That you have it all under control, Lord. So anyone here this evening that has anything that is causing those waves to move back and forth, to keep you unsettled, to disturb the peace that God is trying to give you, I encourage you to give it to Jesus here this evening, to let Jesus be the calmer of the storm, to focus on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith here this evening. And we just lift up his name. Let's lift up our hands to him, because Jesus is here. The Holy Spirit is here. We're going to give it all to Jesus here this evening. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to be here in your presence. Thank you for allowing us to rest in your presence, Lord God. Because you, Lord, you are Lord of all, and we give it to you this evening. So we thank you and we praise you, Lord, for who you are here this evening. Be still and know that he is God. Be still. Tell that problem to be still. Tell that struggle to be still. Tell that unsettling thing in your mind and in your heart to be still. Because it has to bow down to the name of Jesus here this evening. Amen.
Comments on this feed. And as the ushers come up, I just want to read out of
Acts 20:35. You can definitely turn there if you would like. And the Word of God says, I have shown you in every way by laboring like this that you must support the weak. And remember the words of the Lord Jesus that he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Amen. Let's go before the Lord. Lord, Father, Jesus, Holy Spirit, we just thank you. We thank you for allowing us to be here together. We thank you for allowing us to pour into your kingdom one more time, Lord. Take these offerings where you want to take them, Lord. Touch the hearts of the people that you want to touch, Lord God. We just come here thankful, Lord God, in obedience to give back to you, Lord God, because it all belongs to you anyway, Lord. So we just thank you. We thank you for our jobs. We thank you for the strength that you give us. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that keeps edifying us, Lord, to have that compassion, Lord, to release what belongs to you. So, Jesus, have your way. Have your way in these offerings, Lord God, and multiply them. Bless those that aren't able to give right now, Lord God, but also show them that through faith, Lord God, that you can help, that you can restore, Lord, that you can provide, Lord God. So we just thank you and we praise you. Bless these offerings in Jesus' name. Amen.
Listen to the story, okay, pay attention, because it's it's very, it was interesting when I found it. I thought it was really interesting how God is just, he's just so detailed in everything that how he brought us into this world, amen? So, the story goes like this, and I feel like you guys can hear me breathing. So, have you heard the story of the Jim twins? Jim Springer and Jim Lewis. I didn't say Jerry Springer, I said Jim Springer and Jerry Lewis. And I was looking at him, I was like, wait a minute, is this that weird guy on TV? No, it wasn't. So, Jim Springer and Jim Lewis were twins of a 14-year-old Italian girl. She gave birth to them in a small town in Ohio and then disappeared. Okay? So having been abandoned, they were adopted into separate families, very loving families, and each one grew up in different areas, and also knowing that they had a twin brother. They knew that. Jim Lewis was driven by a desire to find his twin brother. Although they both lived in Ohio, one was in Limo and the other one was in Dayton, Ohio, but they had never met. Finally, after 39 years of separation, through the help of a probate court judge, they found one another. Jim Lewis drove to Dayton to meet the brother for the very first time in 39 years. He found the house, and obviously he was very nervous, so he kept driving around. Finally, he knocked at the door. When Jim Lewis and Jim Springer met for the first time, they stood staring at each other, speechless. They said that it was like looking into a mirror. They were so much alike. They discovered that they talked, they looked, thought, acted alike, and it was even like kind of spooky, right? Both men also had the same hobby. Remember, they're like, haven't even been around each other. Never in their whole entire lives. It's just totally different. They did woodworking, both of them, and both had just finished building wood furniture for their homes. So they're like finding out, you know, everything that they were doing. Even stranger, the first wife of each man had been named Linda. Both had been divorced. Both men's second wife was named Betty. What in the world, right? Like, what are they all? Like, God is just, he's God, you know? Like, I'm reading this, I'm just like, there's just no way anybody, you know? To me, that just magnified everything, you know, how God just makes us so special and so, we're so unique, you know, but yet these two were yet very alike. And those separated for 39 years, they were just super amazed at how much similarities they have. And well, that's the same similarities that Christ wants for us to have with him. Amen? So that's where I'm going. He wants us to think like him. He wants us to talk like him. He wants us to be just like him. Amen? And that's what our desire should be. And the reason I wanted to talk about this too is because, you know, we're moving into a new building. We're moving into a different neighborhood. We're going to do outreach. And what do people need to see? They need to see Jesus in us. You know, we need to walk like him. We need to talk like him. God's going to use us in evangelism. I feel like evangelism is going to blow up because we need to outreach. You know, we need to go and we need to share God's word and we need to invite people to church. So what better way to do this than to prepare ourselves and start preparing our minds, preparing, you know, ourselves to be more like him. Amen? Amen. So, Apostle John may be suggesting the same idea here. If you turn to 1 John 3:2, it says, "Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for he shall see him as he is. For for we shall see him as he is. But John wasn't talking about here is just for our appearance. Amen. He wasn't just saying just look like Jesus. That's I don't believe that that's what he's saying here. Especially when the Bible urges us to become more and more like Christ, like Jesus in the way that we think and talk and behave. Amen. It's very important. Sometimes I know it's really hard. It's hard for us as Christians to be like Christ, you know, like Jesus. You know, who am I kidding? I mean, we all struggle with that. You know, we all have our times where we may fall short, and yeah, sometimes it's a lot. You know, we fall short a lot. Amen. To behave like Christians, okay, so we try, but sometimes we may lose our tempers.
Come on.
Not anybody here, right? We don't lose our tempers. And then we end up behaving like the world, amen? So that is the difference that we wanna do here, is we wanna be in Ephesians 4:2, and I'm gonna go through the scriptures really quickly, and I know Kayla has them. Listen to these words. Be completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. And again, in Hebrews 12:14, make every effort to live in peace with all men and to be holy. Amen. So that's what God wants for us. That's how we are to be more like Him. These verses say the same thing. It may be difficult at times, and not everybody will be easy to love, you know, because that's how it is. But if possible, as far as we're concerned, we are to live in peace and harmony with one another. Plain and simple. We have to. I mean, that's a commandment, okay? So not just the people we like or like the people that we have like the same interests with or the same hobby. It's easy to, you know, to be good with them, you know, but God's going to bring so many different people, you know, like I see our family here. We've all, like, we're a church family. Like, we know, you know, we know who likes this, or we know how to treat this person, or that person doesn't play like that, or that person, you know, we know each other. But as God takes us to a new building, we're going to have different, you know, different types of people that we're going to have to get to know. We're going to love, and we're going to have to be open to change, and we're going to have to be, you know, some people may not rub, they may rub us the wrong way, you know, but guess what? They're God's children. We have to love them, and we have to be Christ-like, and we have to show that love regardless. Amen? So, number one, and I just have 2 points really quickly. The importance of love in our lives, and he's saying, I want to show you the best way to care of every situation, and that way is to love. When he points out that love is more important than four things, we're going to talk about 4 things that love is more important than, okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So, in verse 1, Paul says that love is more important than spiritual gifts. When I was reading this, because, you know, we just had a spiritual gifts class, and I loved it. I mean, oh my gosh. You know, I think I ended up being in the mercy side and in the...
Exhortation?
Yeah. It was a really interesting class. I loved it. So when I was reading this, I thought, oh my gosh, it makes sense. Because guess what? When we learned our spiritual gifts, we also learned what the bad habits that we have within our spiritual gifts. And one of the things that really stood out to me with that is because I am merciful, sometimes, like for example, say somebody's like going through financial problems and, you know, they're struggling and me, being a merciful person, I'm like, oh my gosh, here you go, like, you know, with my kids or whoever it may be, you know, here's, you know, some money or whatever. But they said, well, but you know what? You might be stopping God from showing them something that they're having to deal with their own, you know, areas in life, you know. And so that was one of my, and I was like, wow, that's so true, you know. So it's really important. But back to my messages, all your spiritual gifts are good, and it's good to know them, but without love, they mean nothing.
That's right.
Okay? So that's what he's saying here. If in verse 1, Paul says that love is more important than spiritual gifts. If I, and this is in 1 Corinthians 13:1, it says, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. And we've all heard that before. And what it means is, it's on the day of Pentecost when the first, when the very first gospel sermon was ever preached, God gave the apostles a special gift of being able to speak in tongues. And they had never, so the people that were hearing it could understand. So that's what was being said. That's what's being said here. Okay, so let me get back to, I'm getting myself all worked up here. On the day of Pentecost, when the very first gospel sermon was ever preached, God gave the apostles the special gift of being able to speak in tongues that they had never learned, so that the people hearing them could understand what was being said.
Amen.
But here in Corinthians, Paul says that if God gave him the gift of speaking every human language, and even the heavenly language of the angels, but he didn't have love, didn't mean anything.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
And that's where he says that, but if he didn't have love, that would be nothing. More than, that's just like noise or a clanging cymbal. Now, what did he mean by that? Back in the first century, there was a big gong or cymbal hanging. And I think somebody preached about that a while back. At the entrance of the temple. And when the people came to worship, they would hit the gong to awake the gods to listen to their prayers. Okay? Here, Paul is saying that even if he were so blessed that he could speak with the greatest of eloquence in every language, but didn't have love, then his life was useless. It's as ridiculous as striking a gong to awaken non-existing gods. Amen? So, see, according to Paul, love is more important than any spiritual gift. In verse 2, Paul says that love is more important than knowledge, even.
Yes.
You know?
Right.
If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all the knowledge, but have not love, I am nothing. And that's in 1 Corinthians 13:2. Paul says that even if you know everything there is to know about medicine, about psychology, about philosophy, all the ologies that you can think of, it means nothing. It means nothing. So why? Paul says in 1 Corinthians 8:1, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. And that's what's so important, amen? You can know everything, the Bible back and forth, but if you don't have any love, if nobody's going to listen, first of all, to you, then what do you have? What are you going to get from that, amen? There's got to be a balance. You have to have love in everything that you do. I don't think we need more knowledge nearly as much as we need more love, amen? For the hearts of the people need a change before society will ever change. And that's huge right now. We need that. Thirdly, Paul says that love is more important than faith. Now, he doesn't say that faith is not important, so don't get me wrong. He says that love is more important. He says, if I have faith that can move mountains but not love, I am nothing. And that's in 1 Corinthians 13:2. The priest, in Galatians 5:6, Paul says, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. So that's the only thing that counts. Fourthly, love is more important than generosity. So I'm already going down the fourth point, and I'm probably going really fast. But says Paul says here, if I give all possession to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. And that's 1 Corinthians 13:3 as well. If the only reason that I give is to receive, then love is not there. So giving is empty, you know? If I'm giving just because I want everybody to know that I'm giving, you know, oh, I'm helping out this sister, you know, it means nothing, you know, because if I'm just, and then too, even if you're giving grudgingly, I mean, if, without love, might as well not even give it, you know. So, wanted to, you know, bring that point up as well. The motive for giving should be love. Hold on a second. If the reason that you give, the motive for living, for giving should be love. Love for God and love for God's people, amen? That's what your motive should be when you give. I thank God for this church because we have such a giving church, you know? Thank God because, and I feel it goes, you know, hand in hand. You know, you guys love God, you love people, and you serve and you give, and, you know, it just kind of goes down the line, amen? So Paul is saying that love is more important than spiritual gifts. Again, more important than knowledge, more important than faith, and more important than generosity. My second point is going to be practicing love in our everyday lives. Amen? So obviously, love is very important. Listen to what Jesus says in John 13:34. A new commandment I give to you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. And that's a commandment I was sharing that earlier. Now notice that Jesus says that this is a commandment, not a suggestion. And God never commands us to do anything that we cannot do. So that's something that he knows that we can do. We just don't do it. Plain and simple, we just don't want to, we don't want to love, and we, you know, we get into these little high horses of ours, and that, you know, we can get really ugly at times, you know. We tend to think that, one of the things that we tend to do is we tend to think that love just happens, you know, because that's what the world teaches us. You fall in love like you fall into a ditch. You fall out of love just like you fall out of a tree. You can't help it. Something that just happens, you know. But the Bible teaches us is love is something that we can control. We can control it. God commands us to love each other. So, which means that I can decide to love you. You can decide to love me. Amen? So now, what kind of love is being talked about here in Philippians 2:4, Paul tells us each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. In other words, to love is the same way that Jesus loved us. Think about others and their interests just like you think about yourself and your interests. You become unselfish when you do that. Now, let's apply these areas in our lives. First of all, we see that what would work in a family, amen? You're showing love to to your spouse that maybe doesn't deserve it. He's being a jerk. But you're going to love him anyways, right? So then that trickles down, you know, to your children, because you see, your children see that you're still loving your spouse. You're still loving him. They might not know he's being a jerk at the time, but you're showing that love to him, you know, because God has commanded you to love, you know. But your children are learning that from you. So it's trickling down to your children. There, after that, it trickles down to your church family. So you're, you know, it just, love just trickles down. So it starts with your spouse, and soon it filters down to the relationship you share with your children, maybe even to your in-laws, maybe, you know, everybody around in your family. It begins to spill into your church, like I said, and into the world. In fact, Jesus said, By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Amen? If. And that's a big thing there, is if. We just do it. And because, you know, sometimes you go, oh my God, you're talking about love again. But do we really do it? You know, do we really love everybody that we come across? You know, do you, you know, at my job, at my work, everybody says, we would never be able to do what you do. And I'm just like, I love my job. It's not a big deal. Well, because I have to go into people's homes and, well, not now because of COVID, I don't have to do that anymore, but I have to deal with all types of people. I'm talking like people's houses are crazy. I just treat them. I don't go in there like, oh my God, I'm gonna faint. It's, you know, crazy or whatever. I treat them with respect. You know, I try to hurry up and get my job done, and I just treat them like normal people. And you know, they've told me that before. You know, they're like, oh my gosh, we appreciate that you come and you help us and you don't make us feel like less than. You know, because a lot of people do. A lot of people make other people feel less than. You know. And that to me, it's so sad, but it is what it is. At my job, I can't get anybody to replace me, and I'm off. Like if I take time off, nobody wants to do it at all. I have to just go back and deal with it when I get back to work. It is what it is. That's the way the world. That's the way the world will find out. Okay, so. If we really love each other the way Jesus loves, then we have to develop in our own lives the same kind of compassion for people that Jesus had. And that's what I mean by that, by loving everybody with that compassion. It's a Christ-like compassion will cause us to ask ourselves some tough questions. Amen? And I want you to ask yourselves these questions. What's it like to hurt deep inside and no one knows that you're hurting? Because that's what you're going to come across. Some people that are hurting and don't tell anybody. What's it like to be sick and knowing that you're not going to get well and wanting more than anything else to live? You know, you're sick. You don't want to die. You want to live. What's it like to be handicapped? Have you ever asked yourself, like, when you come across a handicapped person, like, do you show compassion? Do you, you know, do we have that in us, or do we just walk by them and not even, you know, bother? Another question is, what's it like to be a minority, you know? That's a good question nowadays, you know? We're at that. And it's, what's it like to be dealing with marital problems or domestic problems, you know, we're going to come across all of that. Like I said, we're a family here. We all know each other. We're very close, and we all know what each other, because we're so close, you know, we know when somebody's going through it. We know when somebody's, you know, having problems with their children, whatever. But We have to keep that in mind when other people come in that are new. We need to show that compassion. We need to be ready to give them the answer, be ready to give them resources, places to go get help. Be able to send them to somebody in the church here for help. You know, if they need marital counseling, if they need individual counseling, you know, we need to be able to have that to send them that way. What kind of burdens are people carrying? Do we care enough to help them bear those burdens? We need to be those type of people that care. We need to be those Christ-like people with compassion. Amen? That's what it means when Jesus talks about loving one another as he loves us. There's a story that I'm going to share. There's a story about a missionary. His name is Doug Nichols. And Doug Nichols went to India. But while he was just starting to study, he went to India for a missionary. He was a missionary. He was just starting to learn the language. He developed tuberculosis. So he ended up being put in like a hospital, but in India they're called sanitarium. Is it coming in India, right? Sanitarium. It was not a good place to be. It was not very clean, and the conditions were difficult because there were so many sick people there. But Doug decided to do the best that he could in this situation. So he took some Christian books and tracts. He tried to witness to the patients in the sanitarium. He tried to witness, but he was handicapped because he couldn't communicate very well in the language. Okay? So he felt very discouraged. He tried to pass out Christian tracts, but no one would take them because he couldn't explain it to them. Here he was, because of his illness, he would be there a long time. You know, tuberculosis lasts long. But it seemed like the work that he had come to do, because he was there to minister, he went to India to be a missionary, would not be done because no one would listen to him. Because of this tuberculosis, every night about 2 o'clock, he'd wake up with coughing that wouldn't quit. Then one night he woke, he noticed across the aisle an old man was trying to get out of bed. He said the man would roll himself up into a little ball and rock himself back and forth, trying to get a momentum to get up and stand on his feet. But he just couldn't. He couldn't do it. He was too weak. Finally, after several attempts, the old man laid back and just wept. The next morning, Doug understood why the man was weeping. He was trying to get up to go to the restroom and didn't have enough strength to do that. So his bed was a mess. It smelled, there was a bad smell in the air. Some of the other patients had made fun of the old man. The nurse came to clean up his bed. They were mad. They would be mad. In fact, one of them had slapped him. The old man just laid there and he would just cry. Doug said that next night about 2 o'clock, I started coughing again. I looked across the way and there was that old man trying to get up out of bed one more time. I really didn't want to do it, but somehow I managed to get up and walk across the aisle and help the old man stand up. But he too, he was too weak to walk. So Doug said, I took him in my arms and carried him like a baby. He was so light that it wasn't difficult. I took him into the bathroom, which was nothing more than a dirty hole in the floor. And I stood behind him and supported him with my arms as he took care of himself. Then I carried him back to his bed and laid him down. As I turned to leave, he reached up and grabbed my face and pulled it close to him and kissed me on the cheek. He said, thank you. Doug said the next morning there was patients waiting way when I woke, I asked if I could read some of the books and tracts that I had bought. The other question is, so after he did that, because other people saw what he did for that man, it was so easy to talk to them and to try to explain to them and talk to them about Jesus. So the rest of the people were open, you know, to talking to him, and that's all that it took. Others had questions about God, and they had questions about the God that we worshiped and about his son who came into the world to die for them and for their sins. Doug Nichols says that in the next few weeks, he gave out the literature that he had brought, and during the months that he was there, many of the patients and even doctors and nurses in the sanitarium came to accept Jesus and their Savior. He said that, what did I do? I didn't preach a sermon. I couldn't even communicate very well because of the language barrier. I didn't have a brilliant lesson to teach them or wonderful things to show them. All I did was take an old man to the bathroom, and anyone can do that. Amen. So when I read the story, oh my gosh, I was just broken. I was like, you know, someone has said that they will not care how much you know,
right,
you know, until they know how much you care. And this evening, I think about how we just need to show people how we care.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter sometimes what we say.
Yep.
They just need to know, they need to feel that we love them.
Right.
And I just pray that we all get that heart going into this building, that we just are a church that expresses the love and compassion for everybody. All around, because we're going to have all types of different people. I just know it.
Yes.
And we have to be open for change, and we have to be, we have to let God use us.
Yes.
God use us, but love is one of the things that, and I feel like that's what our church has always been built off of, is just love, loving God and loving people. So this evening I just want to go ahead and have you guys stand, and we're going to just do something a little different tonight. Just want you to just grab somebody, you know, maybe somebody that you haven't, that you, maybe just, it's not your normal person, but I just want you to just grab somebody and bring them to the altar or pray for them there. I just want you to grab somebody as we turn down the lights a little bit back there. Just have that intimate time of prayer with that person next to you, and just pray that God would use us in a powerful way. Even pray, you know, ask that person that God tugs at your heart to pray for. If they need anything, have that compassion. Because a lot of times we can all be here, we don't even know what our brothers and sisters are going through. Amen. We need to be those people that care and have compassion for others. Amen. We have our sister Martha. I don't know if anybody knows. She just lost her sister. You know, that breaks my heart. I can't even imagine losing a sister. I have sister Michelle. She's struggling with her mom in the hospital. I mean, there's so much, you know, that all of us individually are going through. But you know what? Guess what? God gives us so much love to extend love to even others that we don't even know. Amen? So go ahead, look around, grab somebody, pray for them. Amen?